And I had a good tour so far. I started off in Ohio and I was in Missouri and Alabama. I had such a good time in Alabama, and I had such a wonderful time in this trip so far. Praise God. God have done so far. Every church that I visit, there's some miraculous healing taking place there. Like really miraculous. The last time when I was in, I don't even want to talk about it. Glory to Jesus. But the last time I was, the one lady was healed while I preached. That's so beautiful. I love that when people just take the word of life and just receive from Jesus. Amen. Amen. How many of you agree with me tonight that Christ is alive? And that God is in this place, and that Jesus got absolutely, and the Father got absolutely nothing against you. Some of you, I'm not so sure. No, He got absolutely, that's so beautiful, love. You are forgiven for eternity. And tonight I'm going to speak about, which I call in His face. And I want to encourage you in this. And if you turn with me in Psalm 34, I want to read there to you in verse 8. It says, "Oh, taste and see the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in Him." And then you can swing over with me to 2 Corinthians 4, 3 and 4 in the New Covenant. Say, "Taste and see." Say that with me. Taste. See, here's what I want to say to you. Many Christians, God brought Israel out of the slavery, and His purpose was to bring them in. And how many of you know that a lot of them die on the road? They never went in. And many Christians today came out of slavery, but they never went in. And it's like they have a wilderness lifestyle of living in circles and living in a cycle of defeat. And God's purpose is to bring you into the fullness of what He has for you in Christ Jesus. And the reason why we are stuck, the reason why Christians are stuck, and I was there, and I was a Christian who lived for a long time as a believer under condemnation and self-condemnation, is because I mixed the gospel with, I mixed the law with the gospel, with the good news of Jesus Christ. And it's very liberating when you hear the message of grace for the first time. Oh, grace is so powerful. Because grace is the very, it's everything about Jesus. It declares everything about Jesus. And it begins to show us that there's nothing that you can do. It is undeserved, unmerited favor. You can't work for it. When you're meritorious, you can't receive. Everything under the new covenant you receive for free. Hallelujah. But tonight I want to take you on a different trail. I want to take you on a different place, which God is dealing with me basically strong in the last 2 weeks. And that's why I call my sermon, In His Face. Because the Bible says in 2 Corinthians, if you can turn with me in Bible, in 2 Corinthians, and therefore, if you turn with me to 2 Corinthians, here's what I want to say about that taste and see. Many Christians taste, 2 Corinthians 3 and 4, I'm going to go in there, but many Christians taste that God is good, but they never see. And that's very important, that you begin to see. And I'm going to read here. And how many of you know that Jesus, that we have so many, under the old covenant, we have illustrations of people saw God face to face. I think it means different under the old covenant than what it means in the new covenant, to be honest with you. And we are looking into the face of Jesus Christ. But did you know that you got a spiritual face? I'm going to prove it to you out of the Bible. How many of you want to see your face tonight? Okay, come with me to 2 Corinthians 3. And I'm going to read from verse 15. He says, "But even to this day when Moses is read, a veil lies off on their heart." Say heart. "Nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty." Now here's the thing is, Moses represents the law. So when Moses is read, a veil came over the heart. "But nevertheless, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away." Now, the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. So with other words, when the veil is taken away, suddenly the Spirit of God begins to work freedom and liberty into our lives. Don't you think it's awesome when you are a child of God And you begin to discover the liberty and the freedom that we have in Jesus Christ in our walk. Now let's go on here. Then he say in verse 18, but we all with unveiled face. Okay. Say unveiled face. Where does the veil come over? Over the heart? If we read Moses, the Bible says a veil came over the heart. If the veil is taken away, the Bible says with unveiled face. So your face is your heart, your spiritual heart. Are you guys still with me? You get that? Oh, if you get that, you're going to get everything I say from here on. Because that was a huge, that was very high. You guys got that? That's a joke. But anyway, so your heart is your face. Woo! That's why Paul pray in Ephesians. Is it only me that's excited? Thank you for the enthusiasm. Some of you are like, come on. But anyway, Paul said in Ephesians, I pray that God will give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him and enlighten the eyes of your heart. Some translations say understanding. Can I tell you something, how powerful is your heart? This thing is really powerful. Some people think, I love talking about the heart. In 1999, God told me to study the heart because the heart, grace is a divine influence upon the heart. In Hebrews 13:9, he says, let your heart be established in grace. See, if your heart is established in the law, there's a veil over the thing, and your face is closed, guess what? It's your heart that is looking into God, that is looking into your heart. See the spirit dimension. Your heart looks into the face of Jesus. Come on. And what these your heart sees, because with the heart we believe. Come on. With what your heart sees, what's coming from the spirit into your heart, he's going to write on your mind. He's going to bring visions to your mind. And you begin to see things. Man, I want to take you tonight in another place that you step out in faith and begin to say, Jesus, I want to see more. Come on. I want to see stuff in the spirit. I want you to reflect that things into me. I want to see who I am. I want to identify with you. Because the Bible say in 1 John 4:17, the Bible say, as he is, so we are in the world. And you got to see who you are in him so that you can live that life here in the world. Did we start good here? So he says here, with unveiled face, my heart, see my heart, that's the subconscious thing, man. Let me tell you something. I lived for many, many years under condemnation because the condemnation is a guilt. The law works toward condemnation. Many people say to me, yeah, but I'm not under the law anymore, Peter. I'm under the new covenant. I am born again. I am now in the new covenant. I am not. Listen, anything that you do to get God to bless you, you have put yourself under the conditions of the law. Sorry. You try to be perfect by the flesh, you are under the law. Sorry. It doesn't matter what you call it. Paul called it the elementary principle of the world, because that's what the world is all about. I say it everywhere I go, because so many Christians, even sitting in grace churches, are still in their subconscious have an issue. Because here's what I want to say to you is the problem is that in your subconscious, if you have a problem right now, I'm talking about a huge problem. Say, for instance, they diagnose something in your body. Say, for instance, there's huge financial problem or relationship problems. And there is the slightest thought in you saying you don't deserve it. Can I tell you what? Your subconscious, your heart has been influenced by the law and legalism in some way. Are you with me? Because God, see, this is, the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. The Holy Spirit has come to set you free. And there's so many Christians that say to me today, yeah, but I don't understand. I have the Holy Spirit in me, and I have the sickness in my body, and why don't I receive? See, somewhere you believe a lie. Because he's the Spirit of truth. He's not going to agree with natural circumstances or with natural facts. He don't agree with that. He only agree with the finished work of Jesus Christ. Sorry. He's going to convict you of truth. There's nothing else they're going to say to you. So in the subconscious of man, a sin conscience is created. It is in your subconscious. It's a horrible feeling that you have of, it's not for me. It's for some other people. It's for someone else. I don't deserve this. But guess what? Tonight, you're going to be set free. Amen. How many of you got problems? You're going to walk out of here. I'm going to give you a simple, very, very simple, it's so simple, key to unlight the eyes of your heart. And you basically know it, but I'm going to look at it again, and we're going to just hammer that thing again. Because some of us think it's just so wonderful that we have this one benefit. But I want to tell you something. There is so much more in this. I'm going to take you to that. Now let's go on here in this verse. And then he say, this is what he said. Unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord as being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. Say transformation. You know the word glory in the Greek means view and opinion. That's what glory means. I've never seen a glory cloud. Many people say, oh, the glory cloud is going to visit us and we're going to have revival. Whoop-de-doo. I don't think it's going to happen. Are you with me? I believe in an awakening. That's what I believe in. I believe in a revolution of the message of grace. We're all revived. Come on. We've all been made alive. God have already showed up on the scene, man. We are just ignorant and darkened in our minds. That's all. So here's the point I want. If God is good, then God's view and opinion of you is good. Are you with me? That's the view and opinion of God. There's only two. This is not my sermon, but I'm going to throw this in. There's only two glories. If you look into the one glory, it can destroy you. And there's another glory that you can look into that is going to liberate you and restore the image of Christ in you and transform you. See, people say, wow, I pray that we will shine as Moses shined when he come from the mountain. I pray it's not going to happen. I pray that that will not happen with us. Can I tell you why? Because the glory that Moses had that was shining was a view and opinion that the people were looking into, and guess what they saw? They saw death and they saw condemnation. That's the view and opinion that they had. That's what the law is. How many of you agree with me on that? So there's only two glories. You're going to either be under the law and you're going to be condemned and live under guilt, or you're going to come into grace and you live absolutely free of that, absolutely righteous and innocent in the presence of God. Amen. Now listen to this. This is what I love. Turn with me to chapter 4, and I'm just going to read in verse 2. Verse 3 and 4. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded. By the way, I don't believe that the God of this age is Satan. I believe the God of this age is the rules and regulation. If you are good, you are blessed. If you are bad, you are punished. It's the elementary principle of the world. Paul called it in the Ephesians, he called it principalities and powers. Principalities and powers is not demons. It is principalities and powers is what you face every day if you go into the world. It's in the job, it's in the government, it's in everything. But Jesus has given us the grace to face that stuff and live in victory in the midst of that. Are you guys still with me? All right. Now let's go on here. And then he says, and I love this. He says, who do not believe lest the, now listen to this, the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. Say the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ. That's a different gospel. Who is the image of Christ? So if I preach, if we preach the gospel, or you read the gospel, or you hear the gospel, guess what it is supposed to do? The eyes of your heart are supposed to be so open that the image of Christ become a reality inside of you. The gospel that we preach, see, Paul says the gospel is a power unto salvation for everyone who believes. But the gospel that he talk about here is the gospel of the glory of Christ, which reflects the view and opinion that God have about you, which is in Christ, and you begin to identify with Christ, and the same image become a reality in us. You still happy? But we want to be in his face. How many of you know that if you're in love, you're in that person's face? Come on. It's only Brian who get it. How many of you know if you are in love, you are in that person's face? Because with my face, I can show you if I reject you. I don't even have to say a word. Amen. With my face, I can show you I love you or accept you without saying a word. I want to be in the face of God, because can I tell you what? There's only acceptance and love and mercy and grace flowing from that face, from his eyes. In the book of Revelation, we see that his eyes were like fire, you know. And when I was in religion, I thought that was huge judgment and condemnation. But you know what? It's burning of love for you. Woo! Come on. It's burning of love for you, because you are the best thing ever that could happen to him. Amen. See, I want to be in the face of God. So tonight, let's just break down that one little thing. Let's just stop that one little thing. And Jeremiah, believe me, Jeremiah preached it back and forth. From every angle he preached it in this church, I'm just going to preach it again. Because you got to understand what is the reality of this. Amen. Say, in his face. Say, I don't only want to taste. I also want to see. Amen. And I want the eyes of my heart to be open. And condemnation. See, 1 John 3 verse 20 says, Beloved, if our hearts condemn us. See, your own heart can condemn you. Why does it condemn you? When you put yourself under rules and regulations and legalism, traditional Christian. A traditional Christian is occupied with himself. Isn't that true? He's trying to be perfect, trying to win some brownies with the Father, you know, some and stuff like that. I lived there a long time. And what it does is it brings condemnation into the heart, and it destroys basically your faith too. Because the word Jesus is, if you believe and you do not doubt, that word doubt in the Greek. See, if I say to you, believe and do not doubt, how many of you know that the emphasis is on the doubt? But you know that word doubt is diakrino, which comes from the word katakrino. And katakrino is condemnation. So doubt is diakrino. It means self-condemnation. That's what doubt is. That's how simple it is. If you self-condemn yourself, you can't walk by faith. That's why God made us righteous. And he says the righteous shall live by faith. Amen. That's why he gives it to you as a free gift. So when righteousness hit your heart, because with the heart we believe unto righteousness. So when you receive that free gift of righteousness, Jeremiah preached very good on righteousness. I don't want to have to do it. Guess what? Faith explodes in you. His faith. Amen. So let's go on here. I want you to turn with me to 1 John. And we're going to walk through this passage. Amen. You love to do that. And 1 John, and we're going to go to chapter 1, and we're just going to look at one simple thing. If you can get this one thing, and I believe Jeremiah preached it many times and you heard it before, but I want to show you how important it is in seeing in the Spirit, how important it is to see, to look into the face of God. Amen. So let's start in verse 1. In 1 John, listen to what he say. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, our hands have handled concerning the word of life, the life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifested to us. And that which we have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you also may have fellowship with us and truly our fellowship is with the Father and is with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you that your joy may be full. Now, here's where I want to first of all bring your attention to, that he started off with fellowship. And he says, what we have seen, what we have behold, and what we have handled with our hands, the word of life, we declare to you. That's some powerful stuff right there. Now, when I was a more traditional Christian, I used to believe that first verse was written while they were with Jesus on the earth, walking with him, because there was one thing that bothered me in that verse that we have handled with our hands. And I was always thinking of Thomas that touched Jesus after the resurrection. Jesus says, come and put your hand in this wound. And I thought that was it. And the other day I read through it again, and the Holy Spirit says, whoa, stop right there. I want to show you that that verse got nothing to do while Jesus was a natural figure on the earth as the Son of God. That verse is referring to you today. I said, what? Can it be true? He said, yes. So I went into the Greek. How many of you know that we can thank God for Strong's Concordance and the Blue Letter Bible stuff? So I went in there, because the one thing that bothers me there is we have handled with our hands concerning the word of life. And when I studied in the Greek, and guess what? It's a wrong translation again. Because the original Greek says, he said, what we have seen, what we have beheld, and what we can lay hold of, the word of life. So that verse says, as we see in Christ, behold in Christ, we suddenly begin to lay hold of what we have in him. Are you guys with me? He said, and we have fellowship with him, with the Father and with the Son. So when we have fellowship, we see and we behold him. We are in his face, man, and he show us what we have in him, and we lay hold of it, the word of life. Come on, people. It's time that you begin to lay hold of everything that, come on. We need to get out of 30%, 60%, get into 100-fold. Come on. This is time that the church move into that dimension. Are you true? We see things. Some of you sit here tonight, you probably have a revelation of healing, or you have probably struggled with finances and you have a healing revelation. Are you with me? Or you have healing and you struggle with relationships and all that kind of thing. Come on. It's time that we begin to behold his face, that we are in his face, and we transform into the same image, so that his love begin to work through us, and his love take hold of us. Amen. So the people say that that first chapter was written to the Gnostics, and also it also referred to people on universalism today, who says that, well, we don't need to be saved. Everybody's already being saved and everybody's already being forgiven. The Gnostics believe that. That is true, but it also, if I read through that passage and I go through that passage, it also refers to people who do not believe, because he is inviting people. He is saying to them, he's actually, well, let me read the next verse so that I can prove what I say here. Are you guys still with me? Let's go to the next verse here, verse 5. He says, this is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. So they are declaring a message to a group of people. Are you with me? That God is light and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Come on. Now I'm going to stop there and I want to go on. So he's addressing a group of people. He's inviting them and he say to them, come on, don't tell me that if you are in darkness, that you can be in the light. Don't come and tell me that if you are in darkness, that you can walk in the light. Forget that. He said it's impossible. And he's challenging these people and he's calling them into fellowship. He says, I'm declaring to you a message. I'm calling you into light. And this is people who are not born again. Say they are not born again. This is people who are confused and ignorant and darkened in their minds. And he says, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, then the blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse us of, let me just read it again there, will cleanse us from all sin. Now, here's what I want to say to you tonight is, the blood, and this is really important. If you study the book of Hebrews, you will see that blood is a conscience thing. Say conscience. Because a sin conscience was created for the Hebrew people because of the law and condemnation. A sin conscience say to you, you don't deserve it. You don't deserve to be blessed. That's what the sin conscience does. But what the blood of Jesus Christ does, it purify your conscience. Say purify.
It purifies your conscience. With other words, your conscience become aware of the reality that you are forgiven for eternity. Your conscience become aware of the fact that you are innocent. Say innocent. That's what is so important. Blood is always connected to conscience. Many people say, Jesus have already shed his blood. Come on, you agree with me. He's not shedding blood anymore. It is being done. Are you agreeing with me? So the point that I want to make here is the blood speaks to the conscience of man. Because of the blood of Jesus Christ, in my conscience, I know that I'm absolutely innocent. Say innocent. So we're going to get now closer here to the reality, because what he's saying to them, don't come tell me you are in the light, that you can see, that you can behold, and that you can take hold of, if your conscience is not cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Isn't that true? Because your heart is darkened because of the law. The veil is upon your heart. The eyes of your heart is closed in. It cannot see. See, every time that you hang out with Jesus in the Word or hang out with Jesus, guess what? Your heart has the capacity and the ability to absorb and draw and see things that's in the Spirit. Man, I want to challenge you here tonight. Are you guys with me? It can, because if the eyes of my heart is open, revelation knowledge is flooding my whole being. And God wants you to, sometimes we limit God simply because of the fact of innocence. Simply because we don't have a sub, because if my subconscious, if my conscience is healthy, I will look at Jesus, or I will look at my inheritance, or I will look at the promises of God, and I will be absolutely convinced that I deserve to have that. It's mine. But it's because our conscience has not been changed or transformed to a place that it's absolutely healthy and innocent. Therefore, we struggle to lay hold of the things that God got for us. It's very simple. There's nothing difficult to the gospel, man. Come on. I don't even use heavy words yet. Are you with me? This is the simplest stuff ever. So therefore, John actually is saying here in verse 7, he said, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. John is actually saying that if your conscience is sanctified by the blood of Jesus Christ, have become healthy, and it has in your conscience, you know that you are innocent as a child of God. How many of you know that in your conscience, if you have a sin conscience, it will tell you you deserve to be punished. It will tell you you deserve to struggle. It will tell you you deserve to go through this hard time. That's a sin conscience. But boy, oh boy, if you begin to see that through the blood of Jesus Christ, eternal forgiveness, past, present, and future, has been done once for all, and innocence come into your subconscious and into your conscience. Imagine there was a time, you guys know that there was a time that all of us were walking with a conscience in us. We're not good enough. We're not living up to the standard. We don't deserve to receive anything from God. How many of you remember those days? Now we are coming into grace. And now we are living in a place that we know we are innocent. There's a purpose in this. See, some of us just think, hallelujah, I'm forgiven and I'm tasting it. And it's beautiful, man, and we rejoice. That's awesome. But guess what? Taste and see that the Lord is good. See, guess what? God don't want to only deliver you from the slavery of condemnation and guilt and judgment and accusation. He also wants to bring you into the fullness of what you have in Christ. And guess what? The key is innocence. That's the key. Oh man, this gospel is so powerful. Because if your conscience If you are conscious of the fact all the time that I'm righteous, forgiven for eternity, and I'm innocent in the presence of my Father, come on. There's a voice in you that say, you deserve everything that I got for you. Suddenly, the everything changes. Is it only me that's excited? Bertie Brits wrote an awesome book on innocence. I don't know if some of you have read it. I've read through that book. I'm not preaching his stuff, but I become aware through that book how important it is that the children of God, this for us, it's actually not something that we need to battle with. This is something that we need to live with every day, a healthy conscience that is saturated in innocence, righteousness, and free from sin. Really? This is supposed to be natural. This need to be actually supposed to be our daily walk. We are supposed to walk in the light. See, the thing is, to walk in the light means that I experience. Walking means I experience. That's what it means. So if my conscience is cleansed with the blood of Jesus Christ and made healthy and innocent, I begin to experience the light of His glory. Oh man, listen to this. Why? Because now this light is in me. Come on. I'm going to throw out the revelation that the Holy Spirit gave me this morning. Can I give it to you? Get your books. I'll write it down. I'm making a joke. But anyway, He showed me this morning. He shows me, Peter, I was in the shadows under the old covenant. How many of you know that he was in the shadows? Okay. He said, in the Gospels, I was the light of the world and I was the light of God. And that light was coming out of me. He said, but after the resurrection, I become the glory of God. Why? Because as we look into His glory, the light of Christ become real in us. Come on, people. All darkness is driven out of you. Christ in us, the hope of glory. Are you with me? I found my view and opinion in Christ. That's the glory of God. Amen. And I become just like Jesus walking on the earth as the light of the world. The church become the light of the world. We walk. That means we experience God every day. And people begin to experience God with us. Because they say here that and our fellowship is with one another. It's with the Father and the Son. And He says, and we are, and He's calling them into fellowship. So I'm going to go into the next three verses that is like the biggest stronghold ever. It was the hardest part. Me and Jeremiah spoke about it today when we were in the restaurant. It's the hardest thing that I ever struggled to overcome. And that's confession of sins. Are you with me? We don't confess sins anymore. Are you with me? Some of you look at me and say, well, I'm not so sure, but confession of sin, if you confess sins, then it means you still have a sin conscience. Then it means you don't have a healthy conscience, and it means that innocence have not taken hold in your innocence is not taken hold of your heart. It is when innocence take hold of my heart, the eyes of my heart open up. That's how simple it is. There's no formula. There's no plan, there is no three steps, there's no five steps, there's no 10 steps, there's no performance, there's nothing that you need to do. You just need to see that through the blood of Jesus Christ, you have been declared innocent once for all. Say for all. Past, present, and future. The moment when your conscience is sanctified of all condemnation, your heart is condemned. See, he says, beloved, in 1 John 3:20, beloved, our own hearts condemn us. But God is greater than our hearts. Isn't that beautiful? See, God is greater than your heart. So if you have still that thoughts in you, I don't deserve to have. Come on. There's some of you right now sitting here that your life is limited. Somebody said, no, Peter, man, I'm under grace, man. No, I tell you, here sit people here. A lot of you are sitting here and your life is limited in some areas. Can I tell you why? Because some in your conscience is still the voice of this is it. There's nothing more. You can't have more. See, innocence is so powerful because it is part of righteousness. But I love the word innocence because I look at my grandson, I look at my kids when they were small. Man, they don't have an issue of to have stuff or to live in the house and enjoy everything in that house. Come on. They don't sit around and say, oh, I was such a bad person. I can't have cookies. I'm not allowed close to the fridge and open that thing, you know. I'm not allowed to have anything in it. No, my kids didn't never go on a hunger strike to get my acceptance. Are you with me? And here is the children of God still doing things, fasting and praying to get God to bless them and give them something. If that is the truth, you, guess what? You have a sin conscience even though you hear the message of grace. See, the blood of Jesus Christ has a voice. It speaks of better things than that of Abel. Because what happened with Abel, he died and his blood was calling, what was it calling? Revenge. And it was calling judgment and it was calling punishment. Are you with me on his brother? That's what it was calling. But the blood of Jesus Christ is not calling judgment. It's not calling condemnation. Or a punishment. It is the blood of Jesus Christ speaks and it says you are innocent forever. God will never ever have anything against you because the blood of Jesus on the cross 2,000 years ago satisfied him once for all. There's nothing that you can do. See, if you just believe that, if that comes into your conscience, the eyes of your heart open, you begin to see, you begin to behold, and guess what? You begin to lay hold of the things that you have in Christ. The righteous shall live by faith. See, your heart believe unto righteousness. When innocence hit your heart, guess what? Suddenly you become conscious of the fact that you are absolutely righteous. Righteousness is so much more than just standing before God just as if you have never sinned. Righteousness, that's what it means. He gave me a gift. He made me righteous. I can't help it. Are you with me? I can't try to be more righteous. But there's one thing about righteousness is that if you have been declared righteous, then it means you have a right to the promises of God. You have a right to the inheritance of God. That's what it really means. You qualify to share in the inheritance of Jesus Christ. But in the house of God, oh man, you are an absolute innocent child of God. Isn't that beautiful? Wow. You're innocent. Isn't that beautiful? So let's address this old holy cow, kick him dead once for all tonight. You know? Because sometimes some of you thought, maybe I must confess this thing that I've done wrong. Maybe I will feel better. Whoop-de-doo, it's temporary. It's only temporary. Feelings is going to come back. I was living like that hamster in that little thing. I was living in a cycle, confess my sins, then I feel better. One guy said to me one day, sent me a message. I was under this so-called guy, I don't mention his name, in Canada. I was in his ministry when I came here to Canada. He phoned me one day and he said to me, guess what he said to me? He's my pastor, okay? He's now my pastor. He's going to encourage me now. Guess what he said to me? Do not sin. I listened to this guy. I'm like, okay? And then I don't even know how to respond to that. And then he say again, do not sin. You have a great day. And he put the phone down. And I'm like, okay, am I going to do something bad today that he knows about, that I don't know about? Are you with me? Man, it's like ridiculous, you know. It's like, wow. And I thought to myself, something is wrong in this picture. That's not grace. That's not encouragement. Do not sin. Guess what? I am going to sin. That's the bad news of this all. See, there's sin and there's sins. There's the sin of unbelief. Hallelujah. That's what sin really is I don't believe. That's what sin really is. Yeah. So if I believe in the power of Jesus, I will basically overcome. Isn't that true? Yes. But there's sins, there's things that we do. That's hamartano is the Greek word for that. It's a verb. It's things that we do. But you're innocent. I make mistakes. And if I'm among religious people, they point it out. And I say, freak, I didn't even know I do that. Because I'm among the religious guys. Are you with me? The grace guys don't even see that. They don't even hear that. They don't even care. Are you with me? Why? Because they understand innocence. But the moment I'm among religious people, suddenly the point thinks, oh gosh, I didn't even know I do that. Are you? And for them it's a sin. But for me it's like, hey man, that's part of my lifestyle. What do you mean? You know, it's ridiculous. You know, I was doing contracting, you know, and with some guys two, 3 years ago, we were working on this house doing renovations, and two of the guys were rough in the world, man. I love those guys, man. They didn't know, they don't care about church or anything. The other guy was a religious guy, and he knows I'm a pastor, you know. And the other two guys, they know I'm a pastor. They don't care about that. They keep on cussing and swearing, go on as if, you know, I don't care. I love it. It's just... And one day I hit my finger with a hammer, man. And I dropped that S word like 3-4 times. Are you with me? Man, I throw him out there, man. I'm not even sure if the F one was also part of it. But I tell you, man, it was hurting, man. I throw out that word. You know who climbed on me? The other guys were laughing. We climbed on me, that religious freak that was working with us. He climbed on me. You're a pastor. Listen what come out of your mouth. I don't like religious people, man. This is just freaking boring. You can do nothing. You know, it's like, they're just real party poopers. You know? Isn't that? I don't like it. Come on, man. Jeez. Guess what? Jesus wasn't upset. I think he was laughing too. Really? Some of you have a wrong thinking of him. Some of you think he's sitting there on the throne. I'm not saying go cussing now tomorrow. Please don't understand. Or tonight, you know. You know. Anyway. But stuff happened, man. And we make it this big thing and we live under condemnation and guilt, you know. It's ridiculous. That stuff is not important. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for grace. I'm completely off my sermon here. Let's go to verse 8. Are we there? He says, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. And this is where he really come now and he addressed this group. I think he was addressing the Gnostics, or he was addressing unbelievers who say, today we have universalist, inclusionist stuff. I'm not preaching against them or judge anybody. That's not my point. But this is what they believe. They say, no, nobody has sinned. Nobody has ever sinned. And everybody is forgiven once for all. Hey, let me tell you something. God was in Christ reconciling the world to them, not imputing to himself, not imputing their sins to them. That's awesome. Did you know that God has forgiven everybody? But they have to believe and acknowledge before they can experience that. Are you with me? Or they're never going to experience that. I'm sorry. You know, I don't know how they work that out. There are all kinds of doctrines coming out of it. Seems like that thing is also going downhill now. But here's the point that I want to make is that if I want to be purified of sin before I know Jesus, I have to acknowledge, listen, come on, man, I'm living in unbelief. I've been living in unbelief. I believe now. Are you with me? And I have a sin nature. That's why verse 9 say, he's addressing these people, if we confess our sins, he's addressing the people who say that they don't have sin. But he's not talking to believers. He's not talking to us. Amen. He says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to purify us of all unrighteousness. That means he's purifying your nature, Your sin nature, once for all, from all unrighteousness. How do I know it? Because the Greek word here for sin is hamartia. It's not hamartano. The word hamartia is a noun. It's a thing. It's something. It shows your nature. So we say here, he will purify us. So you can't come to God and confess your sins over and over and over, because what are you trying to say to God? God, I got my sin nature back. Please purify it again. It's ridiculous. God has taken away your sin nature once for all. So if you make a mistake, if you slap your finger with a hammer and the S words come out, I should have cussed at that religious guy too. But anyway, sorry. I hope they're out on the streaming. It's not someone that's saying, oh my gosh, I don't invite this guy to come to my church. But the point that I want to make is, the point that I want to make is that doesn't mean that you now inherit your sin nature again. Hamartia is not coming back. It's impossible. You only confess, and the Bible say in Hebrews 10, the Bible. See, why I'm talking to you about this? Because I want to tell you tonight, you need to get your conscience clear that it's full of innocence, so that the eyes of your heart can open, so that you can see, behold, and take hold of. It's only one thing that closes the eyes of your heart, and that is guilt and condemnation. Amen? But he's not addressing Christians here. He didn't use the word beloved. He didn't use the word children or little children or sons. Not at all in this passage. He did not use those words. So we confess our sins. So the Bible says in Hebrews 10, the Bible says, and God, he says, and I will not remember your sins. I will have mercy on you and not remember your sins anymore. So if I confess sins, then I try to remind God of something that he forgot. Are you with me? He completely forgot about that. He took it away once for all. God have a mind issue, man. He got a mind problem when it comes to sin. He can't remember. Isn't that awesome? You've been forgiven for eternity because of the blood of Jesus. See, if we confess sins, guess what we do? We make the finished work of Jesus Christ cheap. That's what we are doing. We make it just cheap. It's like, oh, it's not really important. When he finished, when he said it's finished on that cross, it was finished with sin. He took it upon him. You were in him when he was on that cross. Isn't that true? You were made alive with him when he came out of that grave, and you were raised up together with him, and you may sit down with him together. So the thing, what am I saying here tonight? It's awesome that you taste that God is good, but he wants you to see, because when you see, this is when transformation comes. God don't only bring you out of slavery, he's bringing you into the fullness. And the way to get into the fullness is to, as we behold his glory, we are transformed to the same image. That means his power begin to work in me. Is it only me that's excited here? You know, I know a lot of, I think a lot of Christians is just blind. And I'm not judging. I was myself there. I mean, I every day, I'm just sitting in his presence and say, God, just show me. You know, I have to give Joseph Prince the credit for this statement. It's something that I learned about Joseph Prince. He, and this is so powerful. He says, the more we see the grace and the mercy and the love of Jesus, if we see that, then he sees our faith. Okay, I need to help you through this. That woman that come to Jesus through the crowd that had the issue of blood, can I tell you something? She had no faith. She had zero faith. Some people say she had great faith. No, she did not. Can I tell you what she had? Can I tell you what she had? The Bible says she heard about Jesus. That's all that she got. She saw the grace in Jesus and the acceptance in Jesus. And she heard about the grace in him and the acceptance that he have in him. And she responded to that. And when she touched him, she was healed. And Jesus turned around and say, your faith have healed you. We don't really have faith. The more that we gaze upon his grace, the more he sees faith in us. We are saved by grace, by looking into his grace through faith. Faith come alive in us. We see his grace, he see our faith. Faith come alive. Faith explodes in us when we begin to see how lovely, how beautiful, how wonderful Jesus is. And all the benefits that we have in him. Man, may Jesus just open up the eyes of our hearts that when you begin to spend time with him, that you begin to see how wonderful, how excellent, how beautiful, how amazing he is. Guess what? That's the things that's going to pull the faith up into your heart, because if you are good to me, I trust you. Isn't that true? And therefore, we can't just tell you, see, God didn't only bring Israel out, he also bring them, he also want to bring them in. It took 40 years, a lot of people die, a whole generation of 40 years, a generation of people had to die. Why? Can I tell you why they had to die? Because when they arrived at that mountain, there was something wrong with those people. And I always say, God, why was this? Why couldn't they just accept the fact? That you call and say, cool man, we will come right into your presence. You know why? And Deuteronomy 1 says, Deuteronomy 1 got the answer. I'm not going to go there. Deuteronomy 1 say, and this is the error of Israel. They believed in their heart that God hate them. Their hearts were darkened. And I ask myself, how in the world can it be possible? After he have done all those miracles for them and they arrive at the Mount Sinai and suddenly they believe in their hearts that God hate them. And then I look back and I realize they were 400 years under brutal taskmasters that serve pagan gods, and the pagan gods that they serve is angry and hate. And it was whooped into them. And here they come out. And that whole generation had to die. And Joshua brought them in. Thank God we are living under the new covenant. Nobody's going to die. We have such grace. We have such mercy and love. So with other words, if you are in a place in your life that you only taste, guess what? I want to encourage you tonight. Take hold of this reality. That you don't have to confess sins anymore and ask the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, to help you, that you absolutely, that you walk out of this place tonight and celebrate in the fact that you are innocent. Absolutely innocent. Amen? Now listen to the next verse, because the next verse people would say, okay, now we got you, Peter. Because the verse 10 says, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. He is not talking to believers. He's talking to those people who believe that they don't have sin in them. He's talking to the Gnostics and the Universalists or unbelievers. And he's not referring to people that is born again. He's referring to people that have not come to that place to confess their sin so that he can purify them of their nature or their unrighteous nature. That's what he is doing there. And then we go into chapter 2, and for the first time, he addressed the children of God. I'm almost done. Are you guys still with me? Verse 2 says, my little children. Suddenly, he talked to the little children. Suddenly, he talked to the baby Christians. In chapter 1, he don't mention any child of God there. Are you with me? And suddenly, say, my little children. Isn't this beautiful? These things I write to you that you may not sin. And sin basically means not to believe. How many of you agree with me that Jesus say in John 16, Jesus say, and when the Spirit of truth come, he will convict the world, say world, of sin because they do not believe. Amen? But he will convict us of righteousness. Ah, come on. So every time you make a mistake and you say, I'm such a miserable person, then the Holy Spirit will contradict you and say, no, you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Sorry. Isn't that beautiful? Huh? Now listen to this. He said, I write that you may not sin, that you may. And if anyone sins, now this time it's hamartano, you throw out, if anyone may have done a wrong thing, he says, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteousness, and he himself is a propitiation for our sins, and not only for us only, but for the whole world. Can I tell you something? What is beautiful here is that Jesus Christ is the propitiation, that means the mercy seat on the right hand of the Father for our sins. We have an advocate. So we don't go to the Father and say, oh, Father, I've sinned. I'm such a horrible person. Please forgive me my sins. No, we have an advocate. That means he presents you holy and perfect in the presence of the Father. The only thing that we do is we just identify with him. Say, identify. He's my holiness. He's my righteousness. He's my perfection. Come on. Hebrews 10:14. By one offering, he has perfected those who are being sanctified. Say, I'm perfected. Come on. So what way am I trying to say to you here tonight? What I'm trying to say to you is this, is that the key to get the eyes of your heart open so that you can see, behold, and lay hold of is just innocence. And understand that the blood of Jesus Christ have made you innocent and that he have cleansed your conscience once for all. You've been perfected. Isn't that beautiful? That's the gospel, man. It's very good that you've been delivered from slavery, but guess what, man? Somewhere down the line, you got to get in and begin to live to the in the fullness of the inheritance. And that doesn't mean you don't have it. You do have it in your spirit. Oh, come on. The only thing that the Holy Spirit is doing is, as you identify with Jesus, if you begin to see in the Spirit, he shows you, you already got it, buddy. And he basically awakens that part in your life. He awakens that in you. That's what he does. But most Christians have a sin conscience and say, I don't deserve it. See, when Jesus went to the cross, he took everything that we deserve. And he nailed it to the cross, took it into his body. When he rose from the dead, we receive everything that he deserved. Come on. As he is, so we are in this world. I was out in Birmingham and I preached on the end of my sermon. I begin to tell the people, as he is, so we are in the world. How many of you know that right now Jesus is not sick? As he is, so we are in this world. Isn't that true? Does he deserve to be poor? No, he's not poor. As he is, so we are in this world. Come on. And while I was talking about that, I said, does he have broken arms and legs? No. As he is, so we are in this world. It's not a spirit sitting on the right hand of the Father. It's a body. Jesus is a body risen from the dead. It's not a spirit. Why is it a body? To present you, so as he is, so we are in this world. Come on. That's why it's a body. Very simple, this. And while I was preaching this in Birmingham, this one lady heard this and she couldn't pick up her arm. Well, she could pick up her arm, but it was very, very painful. She really struggled. She basically just stopped doing that. And she just said, man, that is it. As he is, so am I. Jesus don't have a hurting shoulder. And get what? Came after the meeting out to me and she said, look here, and she lifted her arm up. And there was people who know about her and know about her. Look here, I took that word, I'm healed. As he is, so we are in this world. Isn't that beautiful? Say to the person next to you, you're innocent. Isn't that wonderful? Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you tonight for everybody in this place. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are the Spirit of truth and that you convict us, not of sin, but you convict us of righteousness. And we just thank you tonight, Lord, that you open the eyes of our hearts. I pray that in this audience, people, as they begin to understand that they are innocent and that their conscience, if through the blood of Jesus Christ, the blood speaks to their conscience tonight, telling them that they are innocent. And that you just tonight sanctify their conscience and just deliver their conscience from all condemnation and guilt, so that they not having one thought of, I don't deserve this. I don't deserve to live a better life or have a greater life in God. I just thank you for that tonight, Father. In the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit, you're in this place. I thank you that you minister right now to our hearts. We just praise you for that. All God's people say, amen. Amen.
Now look at your neighbor and say, I'm innocent.
I'm innocent. That's beautiful.
Amen.
Right, did we put the camera off?
I think so, yeah. Camera, is camera off? You don't know. Is this because I told you it's